On behalf of our pastor, Dr. Craig Connor, I'd like to welcome you all to First Baptist Church. My name is David Hecht. I'm one of the associate pastors here, minister of discipleship, and it's a joy to be with you today. If you would please open your Bibles to Psalm 1 this morning. Psalm 1. And I'll be reading from the New American Standard Bible. You may know the name Dr. Francis Schaeffer, and Dr. Schaeffer has gone to be with the Lord, and quite a theologian, quite a philosopher, quite a Christian pastor, and quite a worldview theologian. And in 1955, Dr. Schaeffer and his wife Edith formed the La Abri Academy in Switzerland. And the word La Abri is French for shelter. And this La Abri Academy, which is still going on today, not only in Switzerland, but all around the world, is a place where Christian pilgrims and those who are seeking truth can come and enjoy Bible study and wonderful warm koinonia or Christian fellowship. They can study the scriptures from a biblical worldview and really seek the face of God. The goal for La Abri is to come together, seek the face of God, to study a biblical worldview, to enjoy Christian fellowship or koinonia, and also to really discover the significance, the great significance that we have as human beings in created in the image of God with a fallen nature, the opportunity to be born again as a new creation in newness of life and really fulfill the purposes of God in all of our relationships. And one of the books that Francis Schaeffer has written, an incredible study on biblical worldview, and I would encourage you to make this part of your library, is a book entitled How Should We Then Live? How Should We Then Live? And this is going to be the title for my sermon series over the next couple of Sundays. You know that Dr. and Mrs. Connor are taking a very well-deserved sabbatical. Please pray for them as they're enjoying time together. We pray for their renewal and refreshment and inspiration. But I'll be preaching today. Then next week will be Pastor Rick McClung. The following week, Pastor David Flatt. And then the following week, I will finish up the month of July. And then we'll welcome Dr. Connor back. But my two sermons are going to be from Psalm 1 and Psalm 2. And the title of my sermon series is How Then Shall We Live? And this is taken from Dr. Schaeffer's book, and the byline for that book is The Decline and Fall of Western Civilization and Culture. And the whole thesis behind the book is that without God, and when I speak of God, I speak of the triune God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, without God, without the Word of God, and without a born-again experience, we're just not going to be able to make sense of what's going on. But those of us that have a biblical worldview, and I'm speaking of a comprehensive, integrated biblical worldview that explains everything, where we've come from, why we're here, why things are the way they are, and where we're headed. Unless you understand that, you're going to be confused, you're going to be gripped with fear and anxiety, and you will never be what God desires for you to be in all of your relationships. So I hope that you're with all of us as your under-shepherds this month of July. Please come, please pray for us as we believe we have fresh words from God's word for all of us. But this biblical worldview, the things that we're seeing in the world today is prophesied in Scripture. We should not be upset or fearful about what's going on. All throughout Scripture, we see the creation, the fall, and the promise of the new creation. And beginning in Genesis 15:3, after the fall, there is a promise of this seed of a woman who would come and would crush the head of Satan and would usher in the new heaven, the new earth, and the new Jerusalem. So the meta-narrative of Scripture is creation, the fall, and the promise of the new creation. And we're moving toward that. And what we see today is that the things of this world are slowly passing away. And in 1 John chapter 2, verse 17, the Apostle John says this very thing. The world is passing away, and also its lusts. But the good news is that the one who does the will of God lives forever. The word of God, amen. And so this is what we're going to be pursuing the next few weeks. We're going to be pursuing the face of God. We're going to be meditating on the Scripture of God. We're going to allow the Spirit of God to transform our lives, build our faith, and continue to move forward in faith. Now, in Psalm 1 and 2, if you'll look at your Bibles for a moment, Psalm 1 begins with a very important phrase called, how blessed, how blessed. In Hebrew, it's ha'aish, asherei ha'aish, how blessed is the man. Now, if you look at the end of Psalm 2, you also see that same phrase, how blessed are all. Asher HaKol, how blessed are all who put their trust in him or seek refuge in him. So this phrase, the blessed or how blessed, begins Psalm 1 and ends Psalm 2. And this is what's called in a Bible study as an inclusio, And it brackets this text and puts a parameter on the text. And if you look at the internal structure of Psalm 1 and 2, the literary structure of Psalm 1 and 2, you will see these same words that are used, that the wicked and the sinner and the scoffer in Psalm 1 are the kings and rulers, peoples and nations in Psalm 2. And those who are in a covenant relationship with God, these are the asherei. These are those who are in a covenant relationship with God, those who are blessed, whether it's a man or everyone who would call upon the name of the Lord, are in a covenant relationship with God. And those who do not walk in the, do not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. These now who do not have an unequally yoked relationship with unbelievers, but who do meditate on the word of God day and night, delight in the law of the Lord, will bear lasting fruit in every relationship of life. And then in Psalm 2, we get a picture of a biblical worldview. Psalm 2 is exactly what's happening in the world today. In fact, Psalm 2 and Psalm 110 are textually linked and give us a picture of what's happening in the world today. And it gives us strength and power as we receive the Lord Jesus Christ and understand what's happening. And at the end of Psalm 2, we embrace the Lord. So this is going to be an exciting study, and I pray that you'll be here all the month of July. But let's look at Psalm 1. And again, I'm reading from the New American Standard Bible, the Word of God. How blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He will be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water, which yield its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither, and in whatever he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but they are like chaff which the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the path of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Our Father and our God, we humbly and joyfully come before you in the name above all names, the powerful and holy and transforming and salvific name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And Father, we come to you not in our own righteousness, but in the imputed righteousness that we receive by faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And Father, without the teaching ministry of your Holy Spirit and the transforming power of your word, we're not able to glean the height and depth and width and breadth of this great text and these great principles. So we call upon you to anoint us afresh, lead, guide, and direct our studies. Your servants are listening. And it's our desire that we would leave here changed people because we've had a personal encounter with you, and we love you and thank you, Father, and commit this time to you in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you. The phrase that begins with Psalm 1 and ends with Psalm 2 is a phrase that says how blessed. And this word blessed is not the normal word that you would see in the Hebrew Bible for the word blessed. That word is the Hebrew word barach. But this word is the Hebrew word asherei, which is a different word. And in the Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible, it's the Greek word makarios, which is the same word for blessed that we see in the Beatitudes. And the Beatitudes are Jesus' first long discourse. In fact, the Beatitudes and the farewell discourse in John 14, 15, 16, and 17 are the two longest teaching discourses of our Lord Jesus Christ. And the Beatitudes are begin with how blessed, how blessed, how blessed, how blessed, how blessed. And this is the same word that's being used here by the psalmist in Psalm 1. And it speaks not of happiness or temporal blessing. It speaks of deep, eternal blessings that are not circumstantial, that are eternal. And if you look at that this word, it's used all throughout Scripture, and particularly in the Psalms, it speaks specifically of people who are in a covenant relationship with God. So what the psalmist is saying here is how blessed is the person who is in a covenant relationship with God. Now, this is an antithesis to the sinners and wicked and scoffers that we see in the rest of verse 1. And what we see here in Psalm 1, we see three triplets. We see how blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. Now, these are people that are not in a covenant relationship. The sinners and wicked and scoffers that are in verse 1 are an antithesis to the blessed man at the beginning of Psalm 1. So you have this man or this person that's in a covenant relationship with God, and we have these three groups of people, wicked, sinner, and scoffer, who are not in a covenant relationship with God. And we see these three verbs, walk, stand, and sit. And this denotes a lifestyle that these wicked people, these sinners, these scoffers have a lifestyle because it's the fruit of their life. You know, a sinner cannot help but sin. An unregenerate sinner cannot help but sin because they're not born again. And so that's really all that they know. And so these sinners are these scoffers, these wicked people are doing what comes very naturally to them because they're not born again, filled by the Spirit, and living out the Spirit in their life. So we have this lifestyle of walking, standing, and sitting. Now, the council, the way, and the seat, these speak of relationships. This speaks of a relationship now that the psalmist is really encouraging the born-again believer, the person who is in a covenant relationship with God, not to be yoked with these sinners and wicked and scoffers. So we have the walk, stand, sit. This is denotes a lifestyle. We have the counsel, the way, and the seat. This involves a series of relationships. And then we have the wicked, the sinners, and the scoffers. And these three states describe someone who is not in a covenant relationship with God. This word wicked means those who willingly seek to do evil. They willingly plot and are intentional about harming and doing evil. Those who are sinners are those who transgress the law. They step over the law. They fall short of God's standard for righteousness. And then scoffers are those who mock God, the things of God, and the people of God. And these three, the wicked, sinners, and scoffers, are representative of people that are not in a covenant relationship with God. And so naturally, they're just bearing the fruit of their relationship or their lack of relationship. So what the psalmist is saying is that believers are not to be in an intimate, personal, or professional relationship with unbelievers. And this is our first point, that those who are in a covenant relationship with God do not yoke themselves personally or professionally with sinners. Now, we're going to develop that a little more because we do engage them. But what is being spoken of here is a lifestyle of receiving counsel, of standing with them on the same causes that they have, and then sitting in their seats of authority. It's a whole different thing than just reaching out and sharing the gospel and developing a relationship in order to lead them to faith in Christ. And the biblical example that I'd like to give to you is a very important one, and there are textual, thematic, and practical links to the life of Lot, Abram's nephew, in Genesis 13, 14, and 19. Now, you remember the story of Lot. He and Abram and Sarai and Lot's wife, they left Ur of the Chaldees, they went to Haran, and then down into the land of Canaan. And over time, God has given this land of Canaan to Abraham and his seed. And it came about that their herdsmen were in conflict. And Abram said, "Lot, look out over all the land that God has given us, and you choose where you want to go." Abram said, "You choose." And Lot chose to go eastward, away from God. Anytime you see people moving eastward in the Bible, they're moving away from God. And we know that Christ is going to return, Acts chapter 1, is going to return on the Mount of Olives, go down the Kidron Valley and up through the Eastern Gate. He's going to enter from the east to establish his kingdom in the new heaven, the new earth, and the new Jerusalem. So anytime people are moving eastward, they're moving away from God, away from the presence of God. And it says specifically three times in Genesis 13 that Lot separated from Abram, separated from Abram, separated from Abram. And what this means is that Lot has chosen to separate himself from God, the God of Abraham, from the people of God, and from the covenant promises of God. And he moves eastward, and it says he moves eastward toward Sodom, which was the most wicked city of that day. So he turns, he looks, he starts walking now toward Sodom. And the next time we see Lot, he's now camped out outside the city gates of Sodom. The next time we see Lot, he's living in Sodom, and he's sitting at the very gates of Sodom. And if you know your study of Scripture, when the biblical people were sitting at the gate of a community, a walled city, that they were the gatekeepers. They were the men and women of power of that city. So now Lot has not only chosen to leave God, leave the covenant relationship through Abraham, he's walking eastward. He has his eyes on Sodom, the city of Sodom. He's camping out outside the city gate. Now he's sitting at the gate, and then we see Lot now giving his two virgin daughters over to a perverse group of men. And so what the psalmist is describing here in verse 1 is illustrated in the life of Lot in Genesis 13, 14, and 19. And it's a slow drift. We begin taking our counsel from ungodly people based on ungodly principles. We begin standing in the way as they move toward performing their wicked deeds and ungodly behavior. And then pretty soon we're sitting in the seat. We're actually in a position of power and authority in an unredeemed relationship with lost people. And so this is exactly what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33. Paul says, "Do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals." In 2 Corinthians 6, verses 14 and 15, we see this principle again. "Do not be bound together with unbelievers." He's speaking of believers. "Do not be bound together with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness and lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? Or what harmony has Christ with Belial? Or what has a believer in common with an unbeliever?" And if you study this textually, you'll see he's really bringing forth Hebrew poetry here in the Greek New Testament, because he's reiterating over and over and over and over again the same principle that those who are in a covenant relationship with God should not be in an intimate, personal, or professional relationship with unbelievers. Now, lest we become self-righteous and prideful, and Paul also gives us warning about this. Listen to what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 6, verses 9 through 11. "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor homosexuals, nor thieves, nor the covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God." But now listen to what Paul says. "Such were some of us." He literally says, "Such were some of you," but I'm in that group too. "Such were some of us, but we have been washed, and we've been sanctified, and we've been justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the Spirit of our God." So lest we become prideful and say, you know, we can have no engagement whatsoever to the lost, that's not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is entering into an intimate, deep, transforming relationship as followers of Christ with unbelievers, and we're drawn away from the faith, drawn away from the covenant promises of God, drawn away from the power and the will of God in our lives. But we do engage. In fact, Jesus is our example. In Luke chapter 15, we read, "Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to Jesus to listen to him. Both the Pharisees and the scribes began to grumble at Jesus, saying, 'This man receives sinners and even eats with them.'" So again, what we're not saying is don't have any relationship. what we're talking about is not being yoked with them in a personal or professional relationship. And how we do this here at First Baptist Church, we've now celebrated Maxie and I a year as being your associate pastor, minister of discipleship, and we have adopted from Scripture the discipleship process of share, connect, minister, disciple. Share, connect, minister, disciple. We share the gospel, we share our lives, we share new truth, and we share new behavior. Then we connect people to God, connect people to the church, connect people to Scripture, connect people to their purpose, created in the image of God in all their relationships. Then we minister to people. We help them understand their gender and their spiritual gifts and their calling and their natural talents and help them develop into fully mature followers of Jesus Christ. And while that's all going on, we help them find a place of ministry in the home, in the church, in the academy, in the workplace, and out in the world. So we have a biblical, theological, and practical process for making disciples. And all of our Sunday school classes and small groups and discipleship classes and our evangelistic outreaches and the missionaries that we send out and support here in North America and around the world, everything is focused and moving for that direction. Our mission at First Baptist Church is to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and knowing that the risen Christ will be with us even until the end of the age. So what do we have to fear? And then the vision that God has given Dr. Connor is a biblical vision. We are a house of hope for all people. And so we're reaching out to everyone in a biblical, theological, and practical way through the share, connect, minister, disciple. So we as followers of Christ, we walk by the Spirit of God and the counsel of the Word of God. We stand on the righteousness of God by faith, and we sit at the right hand of God in Christ, that we as believers are seated in Christ at the right hand of the Father. And that's a powerful position and a very humbling position that God has given us. So we do not, as covenant people of God, enter into an unequally yoked personal or professional relationship with unbelievers. But what do we do? Now it really gets good. This really gets good. Look with me now in verse 2. But this person that's in a covenant relationship with God does delight in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. Wow, I don't know about you, but that just bathes me in the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. To delight means to find pleasure, to find great joy and satisfaction. That those of us who are in a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ by the Spirit, those who are in a covenant relationship with God, the first thing that happens to us is we delight in the Word of God. Have you remember what it's like to be a new believer? You know how God just places this love for the Word of God in your heart? And that grows, that builds as we continue to grow in Christ. That love, that enthusiasm, that excitement for the Word of God only builds as we grow in Christ. And so this delight that we have is in the law of the Lord. Now, this is very interesting. This word law is the Hebrew word Torah. And it has several different meanings depending upon the literary context. The Torah, or the Torah, can be the first five books of Moses. That's referred to as the Torah. It can also refer to the 613 laws and statutes and ordinances that God has given us. It can also refer to the Ten Commandments. The Torah can also refer to the entire Old Testament or the Tanakh. But in this literary context, the word Torah or Torah refers to God's instruction that the person who is in a covenant relationship with God delights in God's instruction from Genesis to Revelation. We delight in it. We love it. And we meditate on the Word of God, the Torah, God's instruction day and night. Now, this word meditate is a very interesting word. This word meditate means to read slowly, first of all. Don't rush through the study of Scripture. It means to ponder on the Word of God, to reflect on what is being said, and to think about what's going on. Who's writing? Who's it written to? What are the principles? What does it say about God? What does it say about man? What does it say about us individually? And then it means to apply. And it's what we read about in the Shema. Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad in Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 through 6. That word hear, or the word Shema, means to hear, to understand, to ponder, and then to apply. And this is what is being said here in Psalm 1, that those who are in a covenant relationship with God delight in the law of the Lord and meditate on the instruction of God day and night. Now, this word meditate, throughout Scripture, you see the Bible and the Word of God, the metaphor that's used is food, that the Word of God is often compared to food. And I'd like for you to think for a moment about your favorite meal. I'd like for you to think about the favorite person that prepares that meal. And I'd like for you to think about the favorite place where you eat that meal. And now I'd like you to think about that first bite of your favorite meal prepared by your favorite person, consumed at that favorite place. And imagine the savory flavor and the aroma that just gently or quickly bursts in your senses. And you chew that delicious morsel. And this is what it means to meditate on the Word of God. It means to ingest the Word of God and to ponder it, to delight in it, to savor it, to enjoy it, and to understand what is being said with the purpose of applying it in our lives. And this is what is said all throughout Scripture. In fact, in Psalm 119, verse 103, the psalmist says, "How sweet are your words to my taste, yes, sweeter than honey to my mouth." And as you look through the Bible and see how the Scriptures are described, you see that it's the Word of God that reveals the person of God. The person of God reveals the will of God. The person of God and the will of God, when applied by faith, unleash the power of God, the transforming power of God in our lives. And it's applied in our life by faith. And we come to faith through the Word of God. We grow in our salvation through the Word of God. The Word of God is truth. It's reality. It gives us a biblical worldview. It helps us understand who God is, who we are, where we've come from, why we're here, and where we're headed. I love what the psalmist says in Psalm 19, verses 7 and 8. The law of the Lord is perfect, restoring the soul. And that word restore is the Hebrew word shuv, which means to take back, to turn back to its original condition. That the Word of God is unblemished. That word perfect is the word tamim, which means unblemished or perfect. And it's the same word used of the perfect, unblemished lamb that was sacrificed at Passover and of which Jesus is, who died for our sins. The Word of God is perfect and unblemished, and it restores our soul, the deepest eternal part of our being. It restores our soul to its original condition. The testimony of the Lord is sure, it's reliable, and it makes wise the simple. It brings wisdom, and we can rely on the Word of God. Right now in our Bible study classes, we're studying through Proverbs. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. It's the righteousness of God that is revealed in Scripture. It's a pathway right to God. The Word of God is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And it rejoices the heart. It brings rejoicing to our heart. You have a quiet time throughout the day, and you walk away rejoiced, and your eyes are enlightened, your soul is restored. And then the commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. This word pure means untainted, uncorrupted, and immaculate. And the Word of God illuminates God's truth and reality in our mind, heart, and spirit, so we can move forward in faith and grow in our faith. How do we meditate on the Word of God? Well, we set aside a time, first of all. Set aside a time each and every day where you're going to be alone with God and His Word. Get a good literal translation of the Bible. I would encourage you to get a good literal translation of the Bible. Find a place, a desk, well lit, a comfortable chair, and then get your tools, get a concordance, and get a Bible dictionary, and put the commentaries aside for now. So often we read more about the Word than we read the Word itself. And a concordance, that word concordance comes from the root word concord, which means unity or harmony. And it has every single word in the Bible. And as you come upon a word, look at that word and go back and see how it's used in that section of Scripture and in other parts of Scripture. And you begin to develop a unity for the Word of God. You begin to develop a biblical theology for what you're reading. And you begin to develop a practical theology on how to apply that. And what you want to do is follow the words, clauses, phrases, direct quotes, echoes, and allusions all throughout Scripture from Genesis to Revelation to understand the harmony of Scripture, the grand narrative of Scripture, and these supporting themes that bring forth the new creation and the Lord Jesus Christ. This is what it means to meditate on the Word of God. But now look at the promises in verse 3. The promises. That person that is in a covenant relationship with God, who meditates on the Word of God day and night, and who delights in the Word of God, who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers, will be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither, and in whatever he does, he prospers. The Word of God. Amen. This is incredible truth here, that this person who is in a covenant relationship with God, that meditates on the law and delights in the law, will be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water. A tree in the Scripture brings forth fruit. A tree is a metaphor for stability, for longevity. And shade and protection. So this person in covenant relationship is like a tree. Those same characteristics, the metaphor for a tree in Scripture, are the same metaphors that are used for a believer who meditates on the Word of God. But then a tree that's firmly planted by streams of water. There are two types of water in Scripture. One is stagnant water, which is putrid and diseased and dirty. That is in opposition to streams of water. Streams of water, if you've ever been by a running stream, you know it's cool. And running water cleanses, it nourishes, it refreshes. And this is what we're constantly being nourished by the Word of God and the Holy Spirit as a tree firmly planted by streams of water. And then this person yields fruit in its season. That this is what discipleship is, the fruit that we're bearing in all of our relationships, the fruit of the Spirit, the fruit of righteousness, the fruit of truthfulness, the fruit of good works, that our lives will be fruitful in every relationship of our life. We will bear fruit in every season of life, the psalmist says, and it will be fresh fruit, it will be lasting fruit, and then our leaves will never wither. In other words, you know, when you go to prune your plants, you know, you've got these leaves that are broken and you know, that are dried out, but that's not the life of a Christian who's meditating on the Word of God. Our leaves are always fresh and young and producing fruit. So this is exactly what is being said here. And then in whatever he does, he prospers. Now, that word prospers is not material success. The word prosperity here is the same word that's linked with the person and work of the Messiah, Jesus Christ. And it means to fulfill God's will for your life. That this person in covenant relationship who meditates on the Word of God, who delights in the law of the Lord, will bear fruit in his or her season, and whatever they do, they will prosper because they're following the person and work and will of God in their life. And we cannot fail. We cannot fail in abiding in the Word of God, in abiding in Christ, and bearing fruit. In whatever we do, we will prosper if we're doing it in the Lord's will. Now, if we're off, you know, in the wilderness, you know, we cannot claim this particular promise, but if we're walking in the paths of righteousness, if we're walking in the will of God, if we're meditating on Scripture and living out the person and work of God by the Spirit, whatever God calls us to do, we will be prosperous in it. We will fulfill what God has intended for us to do. And we see this here at First Baptist Church. Are the saints here individually, as families, as small group ministries, as church ministries, we are bearing lasting fruit because we're abiding in the Word of God and we're living out the truth of God and the transforming power of God in our lives. So this is the promise that God has for us. And the end result of that is that those who follow Christ and abide in his word will stand in the judgment. And that judgment is not a bad thing in this case. In fact, the word that's used here is Greek Old Testament is anastemi. It means to rise up. It means that we will be found in the resurrection, which is a good thing. It's the same word that's used in 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18. And we'll close with this. This is the promise for us, and it's the same word that says in verse 5, therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment. That is the word anastemi, and it means to be raised and to stand before God. And it's the same word that Paul uses in 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18, where Paul writes, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. That's that word anastemi, the word stand in Psalm 1. It's also used as Jesus died and rose again, anastemi. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds. This is the Latin word raptizo. This is where we get the word rapture. It means to be snatched. It literally means to be snatched out of here. It's a beautiful promise. then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we shall always be with the Lord. And then Paul says, comfort one another with those words. These are comforting words for us. How do we, how should we then live when we see the things of this world passing away? As covenant followers of Jesus Christ, we do not stand in the path of the wicked. We do not stand in the path of sinners, and we do not sit in the seat of scoffers. We do not unequally yoke ourselves with unbelievers in personal and professional relationships. We share the gospel, we share new truth, we lead people to faith in Christ and disciple them in the Lord and place them into impactful roles of ministry. And we meditate on the Word of God day and night and delight in the Word of God. And we're like a tree planted firmly beside streams of water. We bear fruit in every season, fresh, lasting, eternal fruit, and we will stand before God and we will hear the words that all of us long to hear. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master. And you may be here today and you may not be in that covenant relationship. We would like to give you an opportunity to come forward as Pastor Brookins and our praise team lead us in a hymn of invitation. If you have never called upon the name of the Lord in salvation through confession of sin, repentance of sin, and belief by faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ, we'd like to give you that opportunity. You might be here and you may have come to faith in Christ at some point in your life, but you've walked away from God. You've walked away from the fellowship of the church, and you're missing that koinonia, and things really aren't going so well. There's no one is more miserable than a backslidden Christian. I can tell you that from firsthand experience. There's no one more miserable than a backslidden Christian. So I'm going to invite you to come forward and reestablish that relationship with the Lord. You might be here and you might be in need of a church home. You will never be all that God has intended you to be unless you're active in a local church fellowship. And this is a great one, and it would be greater if you were a part of it. So come forward and express your desire. You might have some prayer needs or some ministry needs. We'd like to hear that. We're genuinely concerned about you, your family, and your walk with the Lord. So you may have masks on, but I can see the glory of the Lord shining through all of you. And so please come forward. Let the Lord have his way with you. Lord, we thank you for this time together. And we pray, Father, that your Holy Spirit would sweep across the sanctuary. Lord, that you would convict of sin and righteousness and judgment, and that you would move people to call upon the name of the Lord in salvation. Lord, we pray that you would move people to call upon the name of the Lord to restore their relationship with Jesus Christ and enjoy the koinonia, the deep fellowship of mind, body, and spirit. We pray for those who are considering a church home and where they might plant their lives and bear fruit that we're studying about in Psalm 1. Lord, we pray, Father, for any decision, dear God, that we might be able to pray and help and encourage and equip and edify, Lord, those who are in need. We love you, we thank you, and have your way with us during this invitation. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.